الحمد لله. الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له. ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، ونشهد أن سيدنا ومولانا محمدًا عبده ورسوله صلى الله تبارك وتعالى عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين، أما بعد. قال سبحانه وتعالى: إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي، يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. اللهم بارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. قال جل وعلا: قل هل يستوي الذين يعلمون والذين لا يعلمون إنما يتذكر أولو الألباب. وقال جل وعلا: يرفع الله الذين آمنوا منكم والذين أوتوا العلم درجات. قال جل وعلا: إنما يخشى الله من عباده العلماء. وقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: طلب العلم فريضة على كل مسلم. قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: ما من عبد يخرج يطلب علما إلا وضعت له الملائكة أجنحتها وصلك به طريقا إلى الجنة، وإنه ليستغفر للآلم من في السماوات ومن في الأرض حتى الهتان في البحر، وإن فضل العالم على العابد كفضل القمر ليلة البدر على سائر الكواكب، وإن العلماء هم ورثة الأنبياء، وإن الأنبياء لم يورثوا دينار ولا درهما ولكنه ورثوا العلم، فمن أخذه أخذ بحظ وافر، أو كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام. Respected ulama, my respected elders, my brothers and my little ones, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. After praising the Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and sending salutations on our beloved Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I begin as always by first thanking you, my host, for giving me this opportunity to convey the message of Allah and His Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I pray to the Almighty Allah that Allah accept these humble efforts of yours in listening to this message, as I pray to the Almighty Allah that Allah accepts these efforts of mine in trying to deliver the message of Allah and His Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as it was revealed on our beloved Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in its true and pure form over 1400 years ago. Now, young friends, the title for this evening is The Importance of Al-Madin. How important is it to people like you and me that declare the kalima la ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah, there is no God worthy of worship but Allah, and truly Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the messenger of Allah. That declare there is no one that we love more than Allah and His Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. How important is it for people like yourself and myself to acquire the knowledge of Allah and His Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? To acquire the knowledge of the Quran, knowledge of Islam, knowledge of the Sunnah. Why should I waste my life learning the deen of Allah? How will learning about the deen of Allah benefit me in this dunya? My young friends, once upon a time, such was the love for Allah and His Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Such was the level of iman. Such was the zeal and jazbah. That every
single companion of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When it came to this deen, when it came to Allah and his Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they were prepared to sacrifice their health, they were prepared to sacrifice their wealth, their properties, they were prepared to sacrifice their wives, their children, they were prepared to sacrifice their lives for Allah and his Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and for the deen of Allah. They would not hesitate to lay down their lives for Allah and his Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Every single one of them, from the first companion of Rasulullah to the last companion of Rasulullah, there was a fire burning inside his heart. And this fire burning inside his heart didn't allow him to rest, to sleep for hours on end, to socialize on a Saturday night, to wine and dine. This fire burning inside the heart of the companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not allow them to rest till they did not elevate the kalima la ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah. Till they did not give everything to Allah and his Rasul, whatever they possess, till they did not give this to Allah and his Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam. My young friends, not one of them from the first till the last would even get to sleep. Who can forget the likes of Bilal al-Habshi? How many times will have heard this? They would persecute him by day and they would persecute him by night. They would whip him by day and they would whip him by night. And when blood would gush from the blessed body of Bilal to add salt to the wounds, they would drag him in the blessed city of Makkah at a time when the sun would reach its peak in a land where temperatures exceed 45 degrees centigrade in the summer months. And they would force him to lie on the burning sun in a land where even the mountains of Makkah cannot tolerate the heat. And that's why you will find that the mountains of Makkah are black. And they would force him to lie on the burning sun. And then they would take a large stone and place it on his chest. And they would torment and torture further. And say to him, O Bilal, لا تزال حكذا حتى تموت أو تكفر بمحمد وتعبد الله والعزة. O Bilal, we will do this day in, day out, night in, night out. We will keep on tormenting you, torturing you, beating you, persecuting you, till you do not leave the deen of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and return to the worships of the idol Lat and Uzza. And my young friends, and Sayyidina Bilal al-Habshi radiallahu ta'ala would respond, O kafiru ahad ahad, you can torture me as much as you like, you can torment me as much as you like, you can kill me not once, not 10 times, 1,000,000 times. You can strip my flesh from my bones and my skin from my flesh. Even then, I'm not prepared to leave the deen of Allah. I will live by the kalima and I will die by the kalima. A fire burning inside his heart. And this fire burning inside his heart, my young friends, he could lay down his life for Allah and his Rasul, not one time, but 1,000,000 times. He wouldn't hesitate. Who can forget the likes of Khabbab? They would brand his head with hot iron rods. This is the same Khabbab. On one occasion, he comes to visit the Amir al-Mu'mineen, Sayyidina Umar al-Faruq radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And just as you're sitting in this gathering around me here, the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala ajma'in was sitting around the Amir al-Mu'mineen, Sayyidina Umar al-Faruq radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Sayyidina Khabbab comes to visit the Amir al-Mu'mineen. And when the Amir al-Mu'mineen saw Sayyidina Khabbab radiallahu ta'ala anhu,
honoring Sayyidina Khabbab and realizing the sacrifices and remembering the sacrifices that Khabbab made for Allah and his Rasul, the Amir al-Mu'mineen acknowledges Khabbab and he invites him to come to sit at the front of the gathering. He honors him and then he addresses the audience. He says, مَا عَلَى الْأَرْضِ أَحَدٌ أَحَقُّ بِهَذَا الْمَجْلِسِ مِنْ هَذَا إِلَّا رَجُلْ وَاحِدٌ That I swear by Allah, on the face of this earth, there is nobody more worthy of this honor, of this seat in which I've asked Khabbab to sit, more than Khabbab, except for one individual. Sayyidina Khabbab radiyallahu ta'ala asks the Amir al-Mu'mineen, who is this individual that is more worthy of this honor than me? Who is this individual that is more worthy of this seat in which you've asked me to sit more than myself? Only
Bilal al-Habshi radiallahu ta'ala is more worthy of this seat, of this place than you. Sayyidina Khabbab radiallahu ta'ala said to Amir al-Mu'mineen, in my opinion, Bilal is not more worthy of this honor and of this place and of this seat more than myself. And then he explained to the Amir al-Mu'mineen, said, oh Amir al-Mu'mineen, Umar, there were times when the Kuffar persecuted Bilal so much. There was times when the Kuffar persecuted Bilal so much the other Kuffar would come to his rescue and save him from the torment and torture of the Kuffar that were punishing him. But Amir al-Mu'mineen, not once did ever anyone pity me. Not once did anyone ever come to my rescue and save me from the torture and the punishment of the Kuffar. And then he said to the Amir al-Mu'mineen, كَلَقَدْ رَأَيْتُنِي يَوْمًا أَخَذُونِي فَأَوْقَدُوا لِي نَارًا ثُمَّ سَلَقُونِي بِيهَا ثُمَّ وَدَأَ رَجُلٌ رِجْلَهُ عَلَى صَدْرِي فَمَتَّقَيْتُ الْأَرْضَ إِلَّا بِظَهْرِي O Amir al-Mu'mineen, I witnessed the day in which they caught hold of me. They started a fire and then they took off my clothes. When the fire became hot, they dragged my body over heaps of smoldering charcoal. And then one of them stood on my chest so I'm unable to get up and run away. O Muslimano, what do you think that put out the fire that day? It was the blood and pus that melted from the back of Khabbab that put out the fire that day. A fire was burning inside his heart. And because of this fire, they were prepared to give all to Allah and his Rasul. They did not hesitate. They could lay down their life again and again for Allah and his Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Who can forget the likes of Ammar ibn Yasir? The entire family. Ammar, Yasir, Hazrat Sumayya radiallahu ta'ala anhu majma'in. The kuffar would persecute them so much that when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would pass by them, when they would suffer, tears would flow from the blessed eyes of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and dampen his blessed beard. And he would console them. And he would say to them, Isbiru ala Yasir fa inna mu'idakum al jannah. Be patient, O the family of Yasir. Hang on there. Your abode is paradise. Allah loves you so much that Allah has elevated your ranks in paradise. My young friends, every single one from amongst the companions of Rasulullah, from the first till the last, there was a fire burning inside his heart. When it came to the deen, when it came to Allah and his Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they lived for Allah and his Rasul, and they died, my young friends, with Allah and his Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Look at their passion when it came to familiarizing themselves with the teachings of Allah and his Rasul, learning the deen of Allah. You have a companion of Rasulullah called Sayyidina Abdullah bin Abbas. Who was Abdullah bin Abbas? His father, Abbas, was the tata, was the uncle of Rasulullah. Abdullah bin Abbas, that makes him the cousin of Rasulullah, his uncle's son. When Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam left this world, I asked you, my young friend, how old do you think Sayyidina Abdullah bin Abbas was when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam left this world? A mere 10 years of age. What do you think his desire was at this young and tender age. What do you think he loved most of all at this young and tender age? How many 10-year-old here is in this gathering here today? There are many of you that will have children around that age at home. What does your 10-year-old do? What did you do when you were 10 years of age? In this day and age, you're with your PlayStation, or you've got your father's mobile phone, flicking through the videos, YouTube, internet, Google, you name it. This is what a 10-year-old does in this day and age. This is his passion. He can't get beyond this. And look at this. 10 years of age, cousin of Rasulullah. And when look at his passion. When the Nabi of Allah leaves this world, he approaches his Ansari friend. And he says to his Ansari friend, Halumma, falnasal ashab Rasulillah fa'innama al-yawm kathir. Oh my Ansari friend, let us go learn the deen of Allah. Let us familiarize ourselves with the teachings of Allah and his Rasul, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Let us go to the companions of Rasulullah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and let us learn the deen of Allah from them. Let us learn from them what we couldn't learn from Rasulullah because of our young and tender age. The Sahaba are in great number and the Sahaba are alive. Look at the passion. And his Ansari friend says to him, peer pressure. وَعَجَبًا لَكَ يَبْنَ أَبَّاسِ أَتَرَى النَّاسِ يَفْتَقِرُونَ إِلَيْكَ وَفِي النَّاسِ مِنْ أَصْحَابِ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ مَنْ فِيهِمْ وَإِبْنِ أَبَّاسِ What dream do you dream? وَإِبْنِ أَبَّاسِ What dream do you dream? You want to learn the deen of Allah? You want to familiarize yourself with the teachings of Allah and His Rasul? Have you got this big dream that you're going to become a great sheikh? A big allama? And people will turn to you from far and wide and come and learn the deen of Allah from you when the great companions of Rasulullah, Abu Bakr, Umar, Usman, Ali, Talha, Zubair, Sa'ad, Sa'id, they're all alive and possess more knowledge than you will ever possess. Peer pressure. But my young friends, look at a fire burning inside his heart. My young friend, no pressure could put out this fire. And in spite of this fire, in spite of this pressure, look at this young companion of Rasulullah. Such was the love that he had for Allah and his Rasul. And to familiarize himself with the teachings of Allah and his Rasul. That in spite of this pressure, he ignores this Ansari friend of his. Wherever this individual would be informed that a particular companion of Rasulullah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is relating the hadith. Even though, my young friends, this was the cousin of Rasulullah. Familiar with Rasulullah. Familiar with the teachings of Rasulullah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He's no ordinary companion of Rasulullah. He would make it so that he would go to this individual relating the hadith of Rasulullah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And many a time when he would go, he would find that this individual is taking qailula. He's taking an afternoon nap. He's taking a siesta. My young friends, this young 10-year-old wouldn't use his maqam and status to his advantage and disturb this individual. No, my young friends, when this individual would be taken a siesta, this 10-year-old child would come to his house. When he would get to the door, he would take off his outer garment and he would lay down on the floor in the burning heat of Arabia, and the wind would blow dust and dirt on the blessed body of the cousin of Rasulullah, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And he would stay there and he would wait for this individual himself. When this individual would finally wake up from his sleep and leave his house to come out, and he would open the door, he would be shocked to see that the cousin of Rasulullah is sleeping on the floor covered in dust and dirt. And this individual would offer the excuse and ask, Ma ja'a bika ya ibn Abbas? Or the cousin of Rasulullah, Ma ja'a bika ya ibn amma Rasulullah? Or cousin of Rasulullah, what brings you? Halla arsalta ilayya fa'atiya? Why do you tell me? I would have come to you. And the child again would humble himself and say, you know, bhai, it's only right that I come to you. I'm the one that is in the need. You are the source of knowledge. You are the well. It is only right that the thirsty come to the well. And the young individual would take the hadith of Rasulullah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, from this individual. And my young friends, indeed his Ansari friend lived to see the day when Ibn Abbas had surpassed the kings. He'd become such a great scholar that you would find hundreds and thousands around Ibn Abbas. Wherever Ibn Abbas would go, you would find hundreds of people are following him. Some are asking him with regards to the hadith of Rasulullah. Okay, what does this hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mean? Somebody's asking him with regards to Islamic jurisprudence. Somebody's asking him with regards to this verse of the Quran and that verse of the Quran. Who can forget the likes of Sayyidina Abu Hurairah radiallahu ta'ala anhu? My young friends, when this Sayyidina Abu Hurairah radiallahu ta'ala anhu declared the kalima la ilaha illallah, he wasn't from amongst the Sabiqeen al-Awwali, like Abu Bakr and Umar and Uthman Ali. Not at the dawn of Islam, they declared the kalima la ilaha illallah, Muhammad Rasulullah. Sayyidina Abu Hurairah radiallahu ta'ala anhu declared the kalima la ilaha illallah in 7th year of Hijrah. 7th year after Khaybar was conquered. Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam stayed in Madinatul Munawwara, in Makkatul Mukarramah for 13 years. 13 years in Makkah. 7th year of Hijrah, that makes it 20 years from the moment Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam declared that I am the messenger of Allah and there is no God worthy of worship but Allah. This is when, after 20 years of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's prophethood, Abu Hurairah came and declared the kalima la ilaha illallah. But from the moment he declared the kalima la ilaha illallah, realizing that he can't compete and he will never be able to compete with the likes of Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, Ali that have declared the kalima 20 years before him and that have benefited from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and have been able to acquire what Abu Hurairah has not been able to acquire because he's declaring the kalima 20 years after these individuals. My young friends, from the moment he declares the kalima right till the Nabi of Allah left this world, wherever you would find Rasulullah, you would find the likes of Sayyidina Abu Hurairah. By day or by night, Hazar or Safar, whether the Prophet ﷺ was in Madinatul Munawwarah or whether the Prophet ﷺ was abroad in some battle, wherever you found the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, with it you found Sayyidina Abu Hurairah radiallahu ta'ala anhu, because Sayyidina Abu Hurairah radiallahu ta'ala anhu from there on took it upon himself, my young friends, that he's not in a position, he cannot afford now to waste 1 second of his life. He's already wasted too much time. He's delayed in declaring the kalima. Now he cannot allow to waste one single minute. This is where, one single second. This is why wherever you would find the Nabi of Allah, within you would find Abu Hurairah. So much so, my young friends, that the Nabi of Allah himself would say to the likes of Abu Hurairah, "Oh Hurairah, what's the matter? Why is it that your friends and your companions always ask me with regards to Mali Ghanimah? They're always asking me with regards to spoils of war and booty. But you, Abu Hurairah, you never ask me for dollars and dimes and pounds. You're never asking me for gold and silver. You're never asking me with regards to booty and spoils of war." And Sayyidina Abu Hurairah radiallahu ta'ala would say to our beloved Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, "Ya Rasulullah, as'aluka an tu'allimani mimma 'allamaka Allah." Ya Rasulullah, this dunya doesn't interest Abu Hurairah. Ya Rasulullah, dollars and dimes doesn't interest Abu Hurairah. Ya Rasulullah, the only thing that interests me is that you give me some of the nur, some of the light that Allah has placed inside your heart. You give me some of this nur. You give me some of this light. Ya Rasulullah, give me some of the knowledge which Allah has given to you, which Allah has placed inside your heart. This is the only thing that interests Abu Hurairah. And this is why Abu Hurairah is with you by day, and is with you by night, is with you in Hazar, and is with you in Safar, whether you are home and abroad. He says, "My friends from the Ansar and the Muhajirin were occupied. Some were occupied with their businesses, and some were occupied with their fortunes. This is me. I was a poor man. I was so poor, I didn't eat leavened bread or wear robes of silk or have servants to serve me." He says, "I was so poor that I would take stones and I would tie stones on my stomach due to hunger. To ease the pain of hunger, I would take stones and I would tie them to my stomach." He says, "Sometimes my condition was so bad. إِنِّي لَأَخِرُّ فِيمَا بَيْنَ مِنْبَرِ رَسُولِ صلى الله عليه وسلم وَهُجْرَةِ عَيْشَ مَغْشِيًا عَلَيْهِ فَيَجِيءُ الْجَائِ فَيَضَعَ رَجُلُ رِجْلُهُ عَلَى أُنُقِهِ." He says, Sometimes I would faint between the member of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and Hazrat Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha's room. Inside the masjid of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And passers-by would pass by. And they would place their feet on my neck, thinking that Abu Huraira has become a madman. Abu Huraira has become insane. He says, I swear by Allah, O Muslimano. It was not because Abu Huraira had become a madman or insane. Days would go by in which I would not receive a morsel to eat. As a result of which, my legs would not be able to carry my body. And I would faint, come crashing down on the ground between the member of Rasulullah and Hazrat Aisha radiallahu ta'ala in his room. He says, sometimes, he says, I would ask the senior companions, the likes of Abu Bakr, Umar, Usman, Ali. I would ask him a question with regards to a particular verse of the Quran. Okay, what does this verse of the Quran mean? And he says, I swear by Allah. I would do this not because Abu Huraira did not know that verse of the Quran. Not because Abu Huraira did not know the meaning of that particular verse. I would stop them and I would question them. Okay, maybe when they look at my face, they will realize Abu Huraira is suffering from starvation. And they will take me home and they will feed me and they will satisfy my hunger. He says, this is why I would stop them and I would question the likes of Abu Bakr, Umar, and Usman. He says, in spite of this, this being my condition, I would be present when the general Sahaba would be absent. And I would remember, whereas they would forget. And he says, on one occasion, the Nabi of Allah said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, whoever spreads his garment, shall I finish this speech of mine? And then takes this garment and places it on his chest. I swear by Allah, he will never forget anything that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam has uttered or said. I ask you, my young friends, in that gathering, when Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam uttered these blessed words, who do you think was the first to take off his garment? None other than Abu Huraira. That fire burning inside his heart for Allah and his Rasul and for this deen and to familiarize himself with his mahbub, his beloved, my young friends. That fire burning inside his heart didn't allow him to let anyone beat him to this when Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam uttered this blessed statement. He says, I took off the only garment that was on my body. And I spread it, just like Rasulullah ﷺ had asked. And I waited for the Nabi of Allah to finish his blessed speech. And when Rasulullah ﷺ finished his blessed speech, I took it, just like Nabi Kareem ﷺ had requested. And I placed it on my heart. He says, I swear by Allah, from that day to this day, I have never ever forgotten one hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He declared the kalima in the seventh year of Hijrah. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam died in the 11th year of Hijrah, Rabi'ul Awwal. Only 4 years with the Nabi of Allah. For my young friends, not a single second was wasted from the moment he declared the kalima till Rasulullah left this world. So much so that in spite of the fact he was not from amongst the Sabiqeen al-Awwaleen like Abu Bakr, Umar and Usman Ali. This day, the ahadith that have reached us, there is no one's hadith that has reached us more than the hadiths of Sayyidina Abu Hurairah. Over 5,000 ahadith, Sayyidina Abu Hurairah radiallahu ta'ala anhu has narrated, which have reached us today. Yet he declared the kalima in the seventh year of Hijrah. There was a fire burning
inside his heart, and this fire was with regard to the Akhirah. Who can forget the likes of Abu Ayyub al-Ansari radiallahu ta'ala?
Traveled all the way from Medina to Egypt. You know, you and I can't comprehend this. And we'll never be able to comprehend this because we live in the era of the Samsung and the iPhone. You're sitting in this gathering here now. And you know what? Within a minute, you can take your iPhone or your Samsung and you can go on to EasyJet, book your ticket, and even have your boarding pass online within a minute. Traveling is so easy in this day and age. But you know, in those days, you know, when they would travel, before they would leave their homes, they would write their wills. Because many people in those days, when they took on long, arduous journeys, they wouldn't return alive. It wasn't as easy as it is today. So you can just imagine traveling in those days from Madinatul Munawwara all the way to Egypt. A journey like that would take at least a month. A month. He leaves Madinatul Munawwara and goes all the way to Egypt for the sake of one hadith of Rasulullah. How much love do you think this man had for Rasulullah? Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You know, Sayyidina Abu Ayyub al-Ansari was no ordinary companion. I call him the fortunate one. Why do I call him the fortunate one? I ask you, my young friends, when Rasulullah migrated from Makkah to Medina, who was the one that received the honor of entertaining Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, none other than Sayyidina Abu Ayyub al-Ansari? So how close was he to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? That was the first house in which the Nabi of Allah stayed when he came to Medina from Munawwara. He saw Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He was in the gatherings of Rasulullah. He would attend regular. He would benefit from Rasulullah. But in spite of all this, look at the love for Rasulullah, that he still traveled from Medina to Egypt for the sake of one hadith. And when he got to Egypt, he met a man called Uqba. When Sayyidina Uqba saw this great companion of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he asked, "Ma ja'a bika ya Aba Ayyub?" "O Abu Ayyub, you've left the land of the Prophet and you've come to Egypt. What brings you to Egypt?" And Sayyidina Abu Ayyub al-Ansari radiallahu ta'ala replied, "O Uqba, one hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Out of all those that directly heard this hadith from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, only you and I remain alive." Listen very carefully to his words. "Out of all those that directly heard this hadith from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, only you and I remain alive." My young friends, when Rasulullah uttered those blessed words, Abu Ayyub al-Ansari was in that gathering. He was in that gathering. And still, he's traveled from Egypt, from Medina to Egypt. He says, "Relate the hadith with regards to concealing the faults of a believer." And Sayyidina Uqba narrates the hadith that our Prophet ﷺ said, "Whoever concealed the faults of a believer in the dunya, Allah will conceal his faults in the future." When he finished uttering the words, Sayyidina Abu Ayyub al-Ansari says, "Sadaq, you have spoken the truth. You have spoken the truth." This is exactly how I recall the words of Rasulullah. My young friend, he traveled to Egypt not because he didn't know the hadith. He went just to confirm the words of the hadith. He heard them a very long time ago. He's now aging. He wanted to see the words that he remembers. Are they the exact words that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam uttered when he and the other companions were in that gathering? Where will you find such love for Allah and His Rasul? And look at the sincerity. Once he's confirmed, Sadaq, that you're speaking the truth, these are the words, my young friends, he turns his mount and he heads back to Madinatul Munawwarah. He did not even stop in Egypt for a bite to eat. He heads back to Madinatul Munawwarah. No, this is not an isolated example. Every single companion, there was a fire burning inside his heart. A man came from Medina to Damascus, Sham, blessed land of Sham, and he came to meet the great Sayyidina Abu Darda radiallahu ta'ala. In those days, people would travel to Sham for business. Allah talks about in the Quran, لِإِلَافِ قُرَيْشِ إِلَافِهِمْ رِحْلَةَ الشِّتَاءِ وَالصَّيْفِ. The Quraysh themselves used to travel to Sham for business. So this man, he comes and meets Sayyidina Abu Darda in the blessed land of Sham. And he says to Sayyidina Abu Darda, "Oh Abu Darda, I swear by Allah, I have not come to Sham for business. I swear by Allah, I've not come to Sham because I've got some need in Sham. I've got some work in Sham. I've come because of one hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam." Sayyidina Abu Darda was so happy, he gave him glad tidings. You come for the sake of a hadith? Then let me tell you the hadith. مَا مِنْ عَبْدٍ يَخْرُجُ يَطْلُبُ عِلْمًا. No servant of Allah leaves his house in search of knowledge. إِلَّا وَضَأَتْ لَهُ الْمَلَائِكَةُ أَجْنِحَتَا. He's so dear to Allah that Allah orders the angels to place their wings for him. He's on a path to paradise. All those within the heavens and the earth make dua to Allah. To Allah, forgive this individual. So much so, from the birds in the heaven, to the fish in the ocean, to the ants in the ant holes. Every single thing makes dua to Allah. Oh Allah, forgive this individual. So he narrates the entire hadith to him. Thousands of miles they would travel for the sake of one hadith of Rasulullah. They would spend years learning the deen of Allah. Today, you and I, in this day and age, it's a carefree attitude. We've got time for everything. We've got time to socialize. You know, we've got time to sit down for hours on end watching the game. You know, the big game. And dare our children disturb us when we're watching Man United against Liverpool or Man City against Liverpool. Dare our wife come in between. You know, some of us, we may even go as far as divorcing her. This is the new religion. People have more regard for a ball and 11 players than they have for Allah and His Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We've got time to wine and dine. We've got time to socialize. We've got time to enjoy ourselves. But we do not have time for Allah and His Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And for those of us that pray, that's as far as it goes. This is the deen. You've prayed your 5 daily prayers, you give your zakat, you fast in the month of Ramadan, and you go for hajj. This is as far as it goes in terms of our deen. And here, you had a man like Ibn al-Qasim. Ibn al-Qasim stayed at the feet of the great Imam Malik for 17 years. 17 years he stayed at the feet of Imam Malik. One occasion, the Hajis of Egypt come to visit Madinatul Munawwara to say salam to our beloved Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So they come to the Masjid of Rasulullah, and in those days Imam Malik would deliver his lecture, his hadith in the Masjid of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now with this group of Hajis is a young man. His face is covered. And he comes and meets Imam Malik. As-salamu alayka ya Malik. And then he asks Imam Malik, "Yo Imam Malik, is there a man here in Medina called Ibn al-Qasim?" So Imam Malik, rahimahullah, pointed at Ibn al-Qasim. Okay, this is Ibn al-Qasim. This young individual, his face is covered. He goes to Ibn al-Qasim and he starts kissing the forehead of Ibn al-Qasim. In this gathering, people are watching. This young individual, his face is covered. He makes his way to Ibn al-Qasim and he starts kissing the forehead of Ibn al-Qasim. My young friends, Ibn al-Qasim did not even know that this young individual that is kissing his forehead is none other than his own flesh and blood. Ibn al-Qasim did not know that this was his son that was kissing him. Why? Ibn al-Qasim left home, Egypt, 17 years ago. And when he left home in such a state that his wife was expecting. She was Hamila. And he said to his wife, I'm going to familiarize myself with the teachings of Allah and His Rasul. I'm going to learn about my Allah. This is how much I love my Allah. I want to learn about my Mahbub, my beloved Muhammad. I want to know everything about him. So I'm leaving home to learn the deen of Allah. When I will return, only Allah and Allah knows best. If you want to stay as my wife, then fine. But if you think you can't make sabr, and it's difficult for you, and you want me to free you and give you talaq, then I can accommodate this. She chose to remain his wife, give birth in his absence. And this was the first time he was seeing his own flesh and blood at 17 years. Never went home once. And you know, if you think giving 17 years to Allah and His Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam is a sacrifice, and believe me, 17 years is some sacrifice. I ask you, what will you say about a scholar called Baqi ibn Makhlad al-Qurtubi? Baqi ibn Makhlad al-Qurtubi, Muslim scholar from Muslim Spain, the very land that the Muslim ruled for around 800 years. He left home twice. The first time he remained absent was a total of 14 years. The second time he remained absent was a total of 20 years. He gave 34 years to Allah and His Rasul. 34 years he was learning about his Allah and he was learning about his beloved Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. What is the Quran and Sunnah? Allah and His Rasul. 34 years of his life. You know, that's more or less half a life. This is the same Baqi ibn Makhlad al-Qurtubi who would live on cabbage leaves which people would throw. You know, the scraps what people throw away. This is what he would pick up and he would eat and he would sustain himself on that. This is the same Baqi ibn Makhlad al-Qurtubi who sold his trousers many a time just so that he could buy paper and write the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. 34 years. My young friends, if you think 34 years is worthy of mention, then I ask you, what will you say about a scholar called Hafiz ibn Mandah? Hafiz ibn Mandah. You know, in this day and age, by the grace of Allah, we find many a Hafiz. In those days, when they gave somebody the title Hafiz, they were not referring to Hafiz al-Quran. Because in those days, more or less, everyone was more or less Hafiz al-Quran. In those days, if they gave the title Hafiz to anyone, they were referring to Hafiz al-Hadith. And the word Hafiz, the title is given to that individual who has memorized 100,000 ahadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Sanadan wa matanan. Sanad, the chain of narration, and the matan, the text. 100,000 hadith. My dear friends, you know, people like myself and yourself can't comprehend this. People like yourself, myself, go take Sahih al-Bukhari. Try to learn 5, Sanad and Matan. Tell me how long it takes you. Learning, knowing 100,000 dream on. How old do you think he was when he left home to learn the deen of Allah? 20 years of age. 20 years of age when he left to learn the deen of Allah, left home to learn the deen of Allah. How old do you think he was when he returned? You know, in this day and age, 20 years of age, what tends to happen? You're either at university, and if you're not studying, your parents will tell you to go get yourself a job. And if you start working, at what age do you retire? 65? He left home at the age of 20. He returned at the age of 65. 45 years he spent, an entire life he gave. An entire life. 65, guys. There are not many people that surpass 65. Most of us drop well before that. An entire life is given to Allah and His Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Who hasn't heard the name Shafi'i? Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah. The world knows Abu Hanifa, Malik, Shafi'i, Ahmed rahimahullah majma'in. How did Imam Shafi'i become Shafi'i? Just like this. For 16 years, Imam Shafi'i sustained himself on dates. He would eat dates. 16 years of his life. And he would only eat as much as he needed to survive, to sustain him. He was so poor, that he couldn't afford to buy paper. Imam Shafi'i was so poor that he couldn't afford to buy paper. He would write on leather, pieces of leather. He would write on pieces of leather, and he would write on stones, flat stone. Imam Shafi'i. 7 years of age, and Imam Shafi'i is sitting in the gathering of the great Imam Malik of Madinatul Munawwara. 7 years of age. It's unbelievable. You know, in this day and age, our seven-year-olds don't know their right from their left. And what does a seven-year-old do? Never mind, in this day and age, you were also once upon a time seven. I was also once upon a time seven. What concerns a seven-year-old? Nothing. The only thing that concerns him is play. He will play in the morning, he will play in the afternoon. He will play in the evening, and if his parents allowed him, he'd even play throughout the night. He has no fikr, no gham, no hum. The only thing that he does is play. And here, you have Imam Shafi'i, 7 years of age, and he's in the masjid of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, sitting in the halaqa and the circle of the great Imam Malik in Madinah al-Munawwara. And it was Imam Malik's practice that when he would relate the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Imam Malik, this is how he would relate the hadith. He would say, an fulan, an sahibi had al maqam, that so-and-so narrates the hadith. He narrates it from so-and-so. And this so-and-so, he narrates it from the one inside the grave. And when he would say these words from the one inside the grave, and sahibi had al-maqam, he would actually point at the grave of Rasulullah. From the one inside this grave, and then he would actually say the words the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had said in the hadith. Now he was narrating the hadith one day, an fulan, an sahibi had al-maqam. He was pointing at the grave of Rasulullah. And when he was pointing at the grave of Rasulullah, he saw this, you know, young child sitting in the halaqa, sitting in the gathering, and this child is playing with something. The child's got a straw inside his mouth, and he's adding his saliva to it. Now this saddened Imam Malik. Saddened him. It cannot be adab, that this child has no adab, no respect. That I'm narrating the hadith of Rasulullah and he's playing in the gathering. You know, what do you think Imam Malik would think about us today? When he could not tolerate as much as this. You know, we sit in these gatherings, and a man sitting like this, boy, you know, as if he's, mashallah, you know, carried a few mountains throughout the day. And you know what? You know, Juma, when the Imam Sahib is delivering the reminder, for many of us, this is where, mashallah, the tamaninat and the sakoon, you know, sakina descends from the heaven. And that's when you're taking your qailula. This is the respect for Allah and His Rasul. We walk in once a week for a reminder, last 10 minutes. And even that, you've dropped off. You know, these people, whether it was with regards to Imam Malik or Imam Bukhari, one of the two, then they bring a hadith on one particular occasion, and you can see the complexion, the color of his face changing. And he continues to narrate the hadith. After the gathering, he asked somebody to raise his garment to see if there's anything in his butt. A scorpion had stung him 16 to 17 times. 16 to 17 times. And he did not move from that position when he was narrating the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is the regard that they had for the words of Rasulullah. How much regard do you think they had for Rasulullah himself? So where was Imam Malik going to tolerate something like this, even though it's a 7-year-old child? Imam Malik was patient. On that day, he narrated 40 hadiths of Rasulullah. He waited for the gathering to finish. And when the gathering finished, he called this young individual, Shafi'i. The child comes, and he sits with respect like we sit in the Sahih before Imam Malik. And Imam Malik reproaches him, tells him off. You have no respect whatsoever. That I'm relating the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and you're playing. You have no regard for the hadith and the words of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. My young friends, this was the response of the young Shafi'i, 7 years of age. He says, "Ya Sayyidi, O my master, O my beloved teacher, ma kuntu abad. I wasn't playing. I wasn't playing whilst you were relating the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I was writing with my spit what you were saying. I was writing with my spit what you were saying so I do not forget. O Malik, I'm so poor that I don't even possess one dirham, one pound with which to buy paper and write the hadith of Rasulullah. As a result, I've got to resort to things like this." Imam Malik was gospel. But he wanted to know whether this child is telling the truth. At the end of the day, he's only a child. So Imam Malik put him to the test. If you're speaking the truth, then narrate one hadith out of the 40 that are narrated in today's majlis. My young friends, the child, the young Shafi'i, 7 years of age, and he sat down with respect, just as his ustad would do when he would relate the hadith of Rasulullah. And just as his ustad would relate the hadith of Rasulullah, and fulan, and fulan, and sahibi had al maqam, and then point at the grave of Rasulullah, the child began with his first hadith. And fulan, and fulan, he pointed at the grave of Rasulullah, and sahibi had al maqam, qala an nabiyyu sallallahu alayhi wa sallam kada. First hadith. Second hadith, and fulan, and fulan, and sahibi had al maqam, qala an nabiyyu sallallahu alayhi wa sallam kada. Third hadith, and fulan, and fulan, and sahibi had al maqam, qala an nabiyyu sallallahu alayhi wa sallam kada. Imam Malik asked for one. The child narrated all 40 hadiths which Imam Malik had narrated in that time. And this is how he became Imam al-Shafi'i. I ask you, my young friends, Abdul Qadir Jilani rahimahullah, who doesn't know of Imam, you know what you call it, Imam al-Awliya, Sayyidina Abdul Qadir Jilani rahimahullah? The whole dunya agrees upon him. Do you think he just became Abdul Qadir Jilani overnight? Days would go by in which he would not eat. Sometimes he would sustain himself on morsels, things which people throw on the ground. He says, on one occasion, dying of hunger, I went out looking for a bite to eat. Maybe I'll find some cabbage which people have thrown on the ground, and I'll pick it up and I'll eat this to sustain myself. He says, wherever I would go, I would find that somebody else has already picked that up from the ground, from the floor, and there's nothing for me. He says, I made my way to the masjid, sat in one corner on the point of death, so weak and eaten that I made my way to the masjid, sat in one corner, and now I'm just waiting for death.
when suddenly somebody walked inside with some bread and curry. He says he began to eat, and every time he raised his morsel, my tongue would move due to hunger. I began to reproach myself, "Yo Abdul Qadir, have you dropped yourself so low that somebody else is eating and you're moving your tongue?" When this real individual realized that Abdul Qadir is in difficulty, he asked him to eat with him. He refused. He says, "By Allah, you must eat." Sayyidina Abdul Qadir Jilani rahimahullah says, "This is when I joined in and I began to eat with him." And then he asked me, "Kibai, who and where are you from?" I said, "I'm from Jilan." The man asked, "Do you know a man called Abdul Qadir?" I said, "I'm Abdul Qadir." He said, as soon as I said, "I'm Abdul Qadir," the color of his face, his complexion changed. He began to shake. And he said to me, "Oh Abdul Qadir, I've been looking for you for days. So much so that my own expenditure, my money finished. I had nothing left. For 3 days, I haven't eaten. All I had was the 8 dinars your mother had sent for you from Jilan. And this food that I purchased is from those 8 dinars. There was a master of hadith called Ibn Tahir. Such difficulty he experienced, he says, a time came when I only had 1 dirham. That's it, 1 pound, nothing else. He says, I was in need of 3 things. Ink, paper, and food, bread. I was in need of 3 things. I only had 1 dirham. What do I do? What would you do? There's no need to ask. We all agree. You and I would satisfy our stomach. We know that even when we're full. Never mind when we're starving. Look at the love for Allah and the Rasul and to the deen of Allah. That this guy has 1 dirham, is in need of 3 things. Ink, paper, and food. And he's now thinking, he's actually sitting down and thinking as to what he should spend his last pound on. His heart wouldn't allow him to give preference to his stomach over the hadith of Rasulullah. His heart wouldn't allow him. How could he give preference to his stomach over the hadith of Rasulullah? That he says, 3 days after this, and I was still pondering as to what I should spend my last pound on. 3 days. He says, on the 4th day I came to this decision that I am now so weak that even if I were to buy ink and paper, I don't have the strength to write the hadith of Rasulullah. When he got to the state of ma'zur, an invalid, my young friends, now he leaves to buy some bread and he places the dirham in his mouth. And he says, by mistake, I swallowed it. And I said to myself, O Ibn Tahir, O Allah, for 3 days I couldn't decide. Now that I've decided, you've taken my dirham from me. It was only when one of his friends realized the situation, did they take him home and did they feed him. You had a master of hadith called Yahya ibn Ma'in. You know, when his father died, he left him 1 million dirham. 1 million dirham in those days, I mean, even in this day and age, mashallah, is something. In those days and age, you can just imagine. You know, if your father were to leave you a few million, what would you do? Buy yourself a Bugatti Veyron? That's your dream car. And you'd be burning some rubber on Bradford Road. That's your passion. What you and I live for? To fulfill our desires. Because for you and me, this is our final abode. This is our final abode. Our action, our amal, clearly say this. We have no fikr for our akhirah. And nor do we prepare for our akhirah. We believe that you live once, live at large. This individual has inherited 1 million dirham.
What do you think he spent his million dirham on? Every single penny he spent on the hadith of Rasulullah, to the extent it is mentioned in the riwayat that even sold his shoes so he could buy paper to write the hadith of Rasulullah. Yahya ibn Ma'in. Imam Abu Yusuf did not attend the janazah of his own son. You and I can't. He did not attend the janazah of his own son. He made preparations, but he did not attend the janazah of his own son in case he missed the lecture of Imam Abu Hanifah. A fire burning in the heart of every one of these Salafus Salihin. The likes of Ishaq ibn Rahway, one of the teachers of Imam Bukhari, he married a woman, not because she bamboozled him and she was God's gift on earth, dynamite. My young friends, obviously you and you know, in this day and age, you're gonna have to see her for about, you know, for a year before you even marry her. You know, every millimeter you need to see. And even then it's not good enough for you. He married her just because she possessed the books of Imam Shafi'i. She inherited the books of Imam Shafi'i. He wanted to benefit from these books. How is he going to do that? Just bring her home as your wife. As a result, they excelled. Excelled. The same Yahya ibn Ma'in who says, I spent a million dirhams, he says, with my own hands, I wrote 1 million hadiths of Rasulullah. Ishaq ibn Rahway would say, whatever I heard once, I would memorize. And whatever I memorized, I did not forget till my last breath. How many would turn up in their gatherings? Firyabi, when he went to Baghdad, sometimes 30,000, 50,000, 70,000. From the top of their heads, they would write books. Abu Bakr ibn al-Ambari, 30 books. Ibn Shaheen, 300 books. Suyuti, 500 books. 500 books. How could you write 500 books in a lifetime? Find me one scholar today that's written 500 books. Scholar in any one. Not necessarily hadith or Islam, in any one. We struggle to write books with Baba, black sheep in it. 500 works and every one is a masterpiece. What to say of Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani, 270 works. Nawawi, died at a very young age. Look how much he left behind in terms of knowledge. Zahabi, Badruddin al-Aini, Asqalani. Name them one after the other. I ask you, my young friends, where do you and I compare with our Qur'an? In familiarizing ourselves with Allah and His Rasul, the more you know, the more knowledge you possess, the more you know your Allah, and the more you know your beloved Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Where do you and I compare with our forefathers? No, the reality is there is no comparison. We live in an era of ignorance. Ignorance prevails. In terms of the dunya, my young friends, how far have we got? Mars and beyond. In terms of our dunya, taraqqi, we've got to Mars and beyond. There are people on the space station which ring from there to the dunya and speak to people in the dunya. This is in terms of our dunya. And we sit in our circles and talk about the galaxy and beyond. And in terms of our akhirah, mind my friends, we don't even know how to wipe our rectums. That is the sad reality. In terms of the dunya, you're talking about Mars and beyond. And in terms of your akhirah, my young friends, There are hundreds of, this is not an exaggeration. Look at the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam out there. You know, you and I, we look at the few that come to the masjid. I mean, I don't know what the statistics are here in Dewsbury. Give you an example of Bradford. How many people will you actually find in namaz? Fajr namaz? A handful. There are well over 100,000 Muslims in Bradford. How many actually pray? How many actually do you think pray? Out of the 100,000, how many will you find in Fajr namaz? What, 2,000-3,000? Is that in all the masajid? Where's the other 98,000? So how many are actually practicing the deen?
1%? 2%? 3%? Let's say 5%. 5%. Where's the other 95%? You'll see them, many of them, on a Jummah. Not when the reminder begins. Your reminder, if Zuhr namaz is at Jummah is at 1 o'clock, and your reminder, the wa'az, the little bayan, the nasiha that the imam delivers, let's say it begins at 12:30. When do the masses actually walk inside the masjid?
You'll have the hajis, your kodjis, here nice and early. But I'm just saying, the youngsters, when do they walk in? Last 5 minutes. They were at the madrasa and the maktab till the age of 12, 13. And after that, never. Probably never even opened the Quran. And there are those that walk in twice a year. For Eid al-Fitr and Eid al-Adha. So where they're going to know masail with regards to istibra. You know, 90% will have not even heard the word istibra. Biggest obligation in Islam is, after iman, salah. First question, أول ما يسأل به العبد يوم القيامة الصلاة. Look at the book of Allah. Every 6-7 page you'll see a mention of salah. أقيموا الصلاة وآتوا الزكاة استعينوا بالصبر والصلاة حافظوا على الصلوات والصلاة الوسطى الذين هم في صلاتهم خاشعون كان يأمر أهله بالصلاة والزكاة إن الصلاة كانت للمؤمنين كتاب every 6-7 page biggest obligation in Islam. If only 2% are practicing and they read their namaz on a daily basis, 98% don't even know their namaz. How are they going to remember their du'a qanood and their tashahud or their durood when they never ever read it? Biggest obligation in Islam. You know, there are people out there, and the Tablighi Jama'ah will tell you this, that travel far and wide. There are people out there in their thousands that struggle to read the kalima as it should be read. They struggle with the pronunciation of the kalima as it should be pronounced. This is the era that we're living in terms of our akhirah, in terms of our deen. You know, the problem is not the ignorance. Everyone's ignorant. I'm ignorant, beginning with me. You're ignorant. Every single one of us are ignorant in comparison to someone else. Allah says, وَفَوْكَ كُلِّ ذِي إِلْمٍ عَلِيمٍ. Above every knowledgeable man, you will find one that is more knowledgeable. So every one of us are ignorant. The problem is not the ignorance. You know what the problem is? The carefree attitude when it comes to the deen. Yes, deen is something dirty, something low, something that you don't have time for, something that, you know what, you couldn't care less whether you were associated with it or not. The teachings of Allah and the teachings of Rasulullah, that's the problem. You've got time for everything, but you don't have time
familiarize yourself with the teachings of Allah. We've got everything. Allah's blessed us, even though we live as a minority in a non-Muslim country. But look how blessed we are. We have masajid, mashallah, in Dewsbury, you have it in every corner. Within a stone throw distance, you have another masjid. We have the masajid. Every masjid, more or less, has got a madrasa. We have the madaris, we have the makatib, we have Islamic schools, we have ulama that speak all languages. For those that are interested in learning the deen in English, by the grace of Allah, we have people that speak English. Those that are interested in Gujarati, you have people that speak Gujarati, ulama that speak Gujarati. Those that are interested in learning Arabic, you have ulama that speak Arabic. We have ulama that speak all languages. All the resources are there. All you and I need to do is pick up the morsel. The meal is being cooked. You and I don't have to do what Baqi ibn Makhrad al-Qurtubi did. Walk or listen to him from thousands of miles from Iraq and Sham and Medina. Abu Yuba al-Ansari, 1 month from Medina to Egypt. You and I don't have to do that. You and I don't have to spend a million dirhams like Yahya ibn Ma'in. It's free. I mean, what does your maktab charge? £5 a week? If not, what's that in comparison to charges out there? You know, when you go for a lesson in maths or English tutoring, minimum you pay is £20 an hour. In here you pay £5 for probably 10 hours a week. That makes it how much? 50p an hour. 50p an hour. And for the elders, there is no charge. The meal's being cooked. All you've got to do is take the morsel and place it in your mouth. But you know what? We're that gone when it comes to our akhirah that we're not even prepared to pick up this morsel and place it inside his mouth. What will you say to your Allah on the day of judgment? How easy can anyone make it for you and me? You're not prepared to do that. You're not, and I'm not asking you to become an alim. Get this out of your head. All I'm asking is 1 hour a week. You've got 24 hours a day. You're giving 1 hour to Allah and His Rasul, and you're familiarizing yourself. You're learning more about your Allah, my Allah. We're learning more about that very person, you can't say people to Allah, astaghfirullah. Allah and His Rasul. We say we love no one more than Allah and His Rasul. And then at the same time, this is the level of ignorance. You know where we're going wrong? Let me tell you where we're going wrong. Where we're going wrong is, why should you waste your time learning the deen of Allah? What will it get you? You can't see the benefit. You can't see the benefit. Even Haji Sab at the age of 90 can't see the benefit. This is why many of our elders, they'll spend their entire life just reading Qul Huwallahu Ahad. Entire life. In Salah. Because they don't know anything more than Qul Huwallahu Ahad. This is how their parents taught them namaz. And that's all they will read. And they will not learn anything else. And when you ask them to learn, what excuse do they need? Tomorrow. I can't do it. The same hadith are when it comes to signing on, making a claim. Man can't even put his back up right. Yeah? And he's got a walking in the sky. And he's struggling. He can't even speak the language. But you know what? He will get there, however it may be. And even though he can't speak the language, when he goes to that office, whatever it may be, in Dewsbury, he will make sure that he's been understood. Because he can see the benefit. He can see the pound signs. Ka-ching, ka-ching, ching. He's not too old for that. He doesn't understand English, but he can read the letters when they're relevant to him. Why? Because this is dunyawi gain. He can't see his ukhrawi gain. And for that, his head doesn't work. He struggles. So we can't see the benefit. I mean, why should you waste your time learning about Allah and His Rasul? What would it get you in the dunya? Nothing. Look. A person learns the deen of Allah, what does he become the most? An alim. What do alims get? Even the monkeys are more nuts than ulama. In terms of wage and pay, mazloom on the dunya is an alim. I'm not talking about your mosque here, guys. I'm talking in general. Wherever you go in the dunya, mazloom will be moliza. Yeah? He's got 10 kids, but he's gonna have to live on £100 budget that you give him. So even a monkey's on more nuts than he is. Yeah? So why would you want to learn the deen of Allah? Because that's what's going to get you. Why would you want to do it? You can't buy a house. You can't buy a good mobile. You can't go on holiday. Put that on your CV and the girl whose hand you're asking for marriage won't even look at it. He said, Molly, forget it. I'm not interested. So why would you want to waste your time learning the deen of Allah? Well, look, everyone dreams when it comes to the dunya, secular subjects. Everyone's got this dream of becoming a doctor. There's no harm in becoming a doctor. Everyone's got this dream of becoming an engineer, and you encourage your children to do it. A pharmacist, a dentist. Why do you dream this dream? Automatically, you see the dollar sign. 100k, get yourself a nice, who wants to live in Savile Town? Get yourself a nice detached bungalow in the suburbs. Get yourself a fat car, the latest Samsung. Yeah? Women will be throwing themselves at you. Put that on your CV, bye. Women will be throwing themselves at you. And you know what? You'll be going to, for a holiday, every year, the Bahamas, the Caribbean, you name it. So you see benefit, and this is why you strive for the dunya and not for the akhirah. I'm going to agree, you're right. You become a doctor, an engineer, you get the dunya. You get dunyavi benefits. My question to you is, how long will they last? How long? It's all about realization. 50 years? 60 years? 80 years? For as long as you live, that's as far as it goes. If you're in a stable job and you don't get sacked, what will happen then? What will happen when you go from here? What, you're going to take your bungalow with you? Who did that? Other than Qarun. Who's ever taken his bungalow with him? Give me one example. From the creation of Adam alayhi salam to this day. Who's taken his bungalow with him? No one. Who loves you most of all? Well, she claims she does. It's your wife. She claims she loves you more than anyone. Look at the vows. You know, when you take the vow of marriage, yeah, when you go to the register office, yeah, what do you say? What does the register say performing the marriage? Till death do us part. Till death do us part. She will go with you when you go. She'll remind you of the vow. Till death do us part. Off you go. I ain't going. This is the one that claims that she loves you more than anyone. Yeah? So even she won't go with you. So these luxuries, without doubt, you will receive if you chase the dunya. But it's temporary. That's the first thing. Are you going to live for a life that is temporary? Or do you want to live for a life that will never end? This is your choice. This is your choice, my friend. Make a wise choice. Number one. Number two. These luxuries are for a very short time. These luxuries will bring about comfort, not happiness. Comfort and happiness are two different things. Mashallah, you've got yourself a nice 7 Series, beautiful leather seats. It's better than the banger that I drive. Yeah? I get a backache just driving my car. Whereas with yours, I'll be floating in on 7th heaven. So it brings about comfort, the leather sofas that you have at home in your front room. It brings about comfort. It's not necessarily that it brings about happiness. Happiness is something else. My young friends, if these luxuries brought about happiness, then why is it that those that possess billions of times more than you and I will ever possess or can even dream of? Why is it that some of these people, if they were happy, why is it that they commit suicide? Why is it that they die of depression? If they were happy, why is it that they turn to alcohol if they were happy? Why is it that they turn to dope and cocaine and heroin if they were happy? Comfort is something and happiness is something else. My young friends, if you were looking for happiness and this is why you're chasing dunya and dunyavi sciences, my young friends, surely even then, if you were looking for happiness, you would have come and learned the deen of Allah. Look at the happiness ilm al-deen will bring about. Ilm al-deen will bring about happiness which our little minds can't even comprehend. I'm just going to give you one or two examples. Look what Allah says in the Quran. Allah, bi zikrillahi tatma'innu al-qulub. Only, listen very carefully, only in the remembrance of Allah, in the teachings of Allah, in the teachings of Rasulullah, in Islam, will these hearts gain peace, happiness, contentment, and satisfaction. Only. You need to possess the knowledge to be able to act upon it. The more knowledge you possess, the more your heart will be at ease, will be happy, content, satisfied. The ghiza, the food for the heart, is the dhikr of Allah. The more you act upon this knowledge, my young friends, the more your heart will be happy. And you'll get to a stage where you actually begin to taste the sweetness of Iman. You'll begin to taste the sweetness of Iman in the dunya, just like Bilal al-Habshi, if you get to that level of Bilal al-Habshi. Look at Bilal al-Habshi radiallahu ta'ala. I began with his example. Why would he not renounce the kalima? They would persecute him by day and they would persecute him by night, but why wouldn't he renounce the kalima? Didn't Bilal feel pain? Was he not a human being? My young friends, if I was to take this individual just as an example, and I took out my cane and started smashing him, how long before this young friend of mine starts dancing to the tune that I want him to dance to? How long before? One, and he'll start doing exactly what I want him to do. That's what pain does. Why wouldn't Bilal renounce the kalima? Did he not feel the pain? Of course Bilal felt the pain. He was a human being. But why wouldn't he renounce the kalima? Because he was tasting the sweetness of Iman. And it was this sweetness that would make him forget the bitterness of the punishment. Give me an example. You walked into Nawab's. You're from Sweden. No, you're not from Sweden, you're from Newsbury. This guy that's walked in from Nawab's is from Sweden. And he's ordered himself a vindaloo, a hot curry.
Because he enjoys vindaloos.
And he's sitting there and he's eating his vindaloo. And smoke's coming out of his ears. He's got his handkerchief in his hand. He's sweating. That's what he does. He's a white guy, he's sweating. And water's coming out of his eyes, his nose, he's sweating. He's going like this. And you've walked inside. And you've seen this guy in one corner, one table. He's got this vindaloo in his mouth. And Bitala's got this handkerchief, and 1 minute it's there, and 1 minute it's there, and 1 minute it's there, he's eating. And you're thinking, yeah, sad case. Bitala, what's wrong with him? Sitting on the table all alone, and he's crying, and he's got this handkerchief. When you look at this individual, this is what you can see. You can see that this guy is suffering. That's what you can see. But is he really suffering? He's come all the way from Sweden because he's heard of Nawab's vindaloo. Try taking that vindaloo away from him while he's eating. See what he does to you. Likewise, my young friends, you know when they would persecute Sayyidina Bilal Hashim radiallahu ta'ala anhu, from the outside, what you could see is Sayyidina Bilal Hashim radiallahu ta'ala anhu suffering. From the inside, such was the level of contentment. Such was the happiness, my young friends, that this beating meant nothing to him. It meant nothing. It meant nothing whatsoever. This is why he was not prepared to renounce the kalima. Because the sweetness that he was tasting would make him forget the bitterness of the punishment. This is just in this world where, my young friends, you can feel like a billionaire and live like a billionaire without a penny in your pocket. Even though you're on some street in India, you have no blanket, the heaven is your blanket. You have no bed, the earth is your bed. You have no pillow, you've taken a brick or a stone as your pillow. I swear by Allah, there are people out there that live life like this and have got bigger smiles than kings and princes in their palaces. This is in the dunya, happiness. Ilm-e-Deen brings about happiness. And in terms of the akhirah, you and I cannot even begin to imagine the happiness. Happiness in the form of what? مَا لَا عَيْنٌ رَأَتْ وَلَا عُذْنٌ سَمِعَتْ وَلَا خَطَرَ عَلَىٰ قَلْبِ بَشَرٍ. No eye has seen, no ears heard. The thought has not been. This is just one benefit of Ilm-e-Deen. If I start talking about the rest of the benefit, you'll be here till Fajr Salah. So I'm going to conclude here and now. The objective is not to give a long speech. The objective is, my young friends, that we act upon what we learn. By all means, do whatever tickles your fancy in terms of your dunya. But bear in mind, this dunya is not your primary objective. This is not your final abode. Your final abode is a place called paradise. For paradise, you need sarmaya. The paradise of Allah is very, very expensive. What will take you there is a'mal. But you can't act upon any amal till you don't possess the knowledge with regard to the amal. It is the difference between heaven and hell. Ilm-e-Deen, in a nutshell, is the difference between heaven and hell. Bearing this in mind, can't you even give at least 1 hour to learn the deen of Allah? And I'm not just talking to the youngsters here. I'm talking to every single one of us. The
الصحابة رضي الله تعالى أجمعين من يبدأ؟ Some of them were old men. Many were, what do you call it, middle-aged men. Abu Bakr, Umar, and many others. Abu Huraira. Their old age didn't stop them from learning the deen of Allah. This is how much regard they had for Allah and the Rasul, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So every single one of us, rather than, you know, Mr. Google, the source of knowledge has to be right. And in this day and age, you have youngsters that are leaving to join ISIS because their source of knowledge is not right. Who is on the internet? Only Allah and Allah alone knows. Take your knowledge from the right people. Stay close, stay benefit from them. Inshallah, it will make a difference in your dunya. I swear by Allah, it will make a difference in your dunya. And it will make a difference in your akhirah. Allah give me the tawfiq. Allah give you the tawfiq to act on what has been said. Akhir dawan, alhamdulillah.